So the idea is he has been motivated by the Hilbert mathematical challenges that have been proposed by Hilbert, collected and proposed by Hilbert back in the 1900, and greatly influenced the mathematical research in the last century. So essentially today's discussion is just a start, because we have to define these challenges better, we have to collect more of them, then we should establish a committee to handle them. For example, I hope that we're going to receive challenges from many different scientists. It's a good thing that such a committee reviews them and accepts or rejects some of them, also merges two of them in one if need be, so that they are useful, because the important thing is to make them suitable for PhD research. For example, we need more detailed definitions. Maybe we need some test data. In my view, it's best if they are more a little bit theoretically oriented, as it is in the case of the PhD studies. There's not necessarily need, for example, to go towards competitions. I know that Taylor has such a formal obligation for AI challenges in their description of action, so we can coordinate with them. And if they want to undertake this task all together, that's fine with me. At the end, if we produce something useful, then we can try to publish an AI research white paper or AI grant challenge research paper or whatever. So any of you that is willing either to contribute a challenge or to participate in authoring this AI research white paper, he or she is welcome to join by sending a message to myself and also to Nicolo that he has contributed so far. So starting with right now, we have two proposals by Nicolo from University of Milano. This is correct, University of Milano, isn't it,
yes, Nicolo? Yes.
Okay, fine. And then I have three proposals by myself. Essentially, they could be boiled down into two, and I'm going to present only the first one. So, Nicolo, now it's, are there any questions regarding the procedure or any recommendations regarding the procedure? Because it's a good thing to help our students to identify good problems and to stimulate some cooperation. Not only the framework of ICT48 projects, possibly beyond. Are there any questions? So then I stop sharing. Nico, it's your turn.
Okay. So let me share. Okay, can you see my?
Sure, fine.
Okay. So yeah, I just have two short slides that are suggesting some themes that by some problems that by all means are not new, and it's not like I want to take credit for proposing, suggesting. These are themes, problems, challenges that have been around for a while now, and I think they are important, interesting. And I'm not an expert in any of the two, so I think that since I've been working in machine learning for a few decades now, I think that I judge them to be important and fundamental in a contemporary machine learning research. So first of all is the learning causal or interventional representations. This can be viewed as a way of bridging between the database and the knowledge-based approach to machine learning, or a way to try to bridge this gap. And this starts from the observation that the tasks that we would like AI systems to perform right now are such that system will have to intervene in the world, interacting with humans and other AI systems. And this, as all we know, as we all know, is creating complex feedback loops. So the problem here is that when you start intervening in the world, a system, machine learning system or AI system, are going to affect the distribution of the data that you're observing. Your own actions are affecting the data distribution. And this is breaking the AIID paradigm on which most of the past research in machine learning has relied on. And so we have now two types of data. We have observational data and interventional data. Observational data is what we may observe when some other agent is acting, and we observe that this data that this agent is producing when interacting with the world. Interventional data are the data that we ourselves are generating by acting, and there's definitely a selection bias because we want to perform certain actions because we have certain goals, but these actions are going to skew the data we are observing in order to improve our learning and to reach our goals more effectively. So, right. So therefore, one way to, one avenue to address this problem is to try to learn what's behind the appearances. And this is the subject of causal representation learning, which if you want is the discovering of high level causal variables from low level observations. By low level observations, I mean the pixels. And in the image over there, you may see that there is a robot manipulating some objects. We might intervene and move a finger of the robot, and the object may fall. And this will cause, a wide range of changes in the pixel distribution, because the object fell, maybe it hit other objects. However, there's a very specific high level of causal representation that is compact and sparse that is explaining what happened. And being able to learn and access these high level causal representations will explain in the behavior of the objects irrespective to poses or visual angles or illumination blurs or any other appearances. This is fundamental in order to understand and reason about and plan in a world where we can perform actions and intervene. So this is brings in several themes, including reinforcement learning and causality and learning with distribution shifts and more. There's a wide range this is a faster growing area with lots of works being published. I may add some references to this slide after today. Okay, this is one thing I wanted to mention. So let me move on to the second one. And this is about a completely different topic. And this is also a very well-known topic. And I would like to give it maybe a different viewpoint, possibly. And this is generalization in large neural networks. So We all know, as it has been mentioned already several times this morning, that one of the most striking success of AI is the ability to learn efficiently using neural networks that are over-parameterized, and meaning that we are seemingly defeating overfitting by using some specific algorithms and certain loss functions on very large neural networks. We are able to generalize despite the fact that the number of parameters is often comparable to the number of data points. And so there must be some hidden bias, you know, lurking there, some hidden bias that is able to constrain the capacity of our learning system and drive the learning in the right direction. And there's a lot of, you know, there's a lot of things going on. There are lots of moving parts here that will contribute to that. And they are interacting with each other. So this is the network architecture, of course, the kind of optimization algorithm that we are using, which is designed with respect to a certain geometry, you know, not necessarily Euclidean geometry. And we have the type of loss functions that we are using, the initialization of the network, the set of hyperparameters, and the way that we optimize our hyperparameters, and any kind of randomness in the optimization algorithm that we are using. So we know that all these factors are conjuring in the in achieving some final performance for our network. And this is because of the over-parameterization. We know that these ingredients are actually giving us a bias, some kind of a learning bias, but we don't really know what this learning bias is. And I think this is definitely a fundamental theoretical problem in understanding the nature of this bias and how the choice of these ingredients and their interaction is actually changing the bias. How to explain how the bias is actually affecting the final performance, of course. Okay, I would like to stop here. So as I said, there are two very short slides, and I leave the floor to Ioannis.
So is there any questions to Nicolò at this stage? Okay, then let's move to my presentation. I'm going to present only just a moment, let me. One challenge of knowledge quantification, because it's related also to at least the other challenge of knowledge education I prepared. Knowledge quantification is a major issue because knowledge is the basis of our society. Yet there is a very big confusion. First of all, we don't have an exact definition, not to mention mathematical definition. We don't even have a philosophical definition of or epistemological definition of what's knowledge. And then there is already a big confusion on the distinction between data, information, and knowledge. And many people, they just think it's all the same and they are all treated by bits and that's it, which is not really fair. When now we want to transform this problem of knowledge quantification to more practical problems that can be researched, then I see two aspects. The first aspect is DNN knowledge quantification, basically knowledge quantification in systems that are data-driven, machine learning ones. And then symbolic knowledge quantification that, as you're going to see, is different. So we have at least two different aspects of knowledge quantification. Let's start with DNN knowledge quantification. Then the first question is, do DNNs possess knowledge? Even this issue is debatable, you know. They can possess some factual knowledge in the sense that you put an input vector to them and they produce a label in most cases. Things are a little bit different when we go to reinforcement learning, because in those cases you essentially learn a function which describes procedural knowledge. So there is even an epistemological question whether CNNs and transforms, for example, possess knowledge. Apart from this, then we have some real research perspectives that we can investigate. For example, you can start probing a trained DNN, and based on its results, you can assess whether it has knowledge on certain classes and the accuracy level and so on. Of course, this is fairly trivial to do, but if you want to do it at a massive scale, for example, you want to check which of the networks that exist around is the best in finding COVID nodules in lungs, for example, then this can be a massive undertaking and it should be optimized. So it's not really a trivial solution by itself. But the real problem in my case is DNA knowledge quantification by researching the DNA structure, because essentially whatever DNA knows or does not know, it's hidden in its structure, in its weights. And then how can you infer directly from the structure and from the weights what the system knows? And then the question is, can we define a DNA knowledge unit? What's this knowledge unit? So far as I've told you, we have the only unit we have is bit, which is an information unit. So that's all. As you see, there are many interesting problems that are open just for DNNs, and things become even more diverse if you go to symbolic knowledge quantification. A major problem there is, you know, that symbolic AI is at an international all-time low these days. Most of the knowledge that we have is in the form, let's say, of logical propositions that are true in sentences that we find in Wikipedia, and all this is symbolic knowledge, okay? So symbolic knowledge quantification is indeed an issue, and it's very important because we have to know what is the knowledge we produce. We can do it by measuring the text that we produce, because in most cases, the concepts and our knowledge is expressed in sentences and paragraphs and articles, in research articles, for example. Yet it's not really enough in the sense that symbolic knowledge has multiple facets as well. It can be procedural knowledge. It can be factual knowledge. We have logical propositions. We have knowledge graphs. Software is a special case of knowledge that can be that is embedded in the software code and could be described in software graphs. So we have multiple different facets. And again, we have similar research aspects that we can investigate. For example, which is the definition of symbolic knowledge unit? I can claim, for example, that a sentence in English, for example, is a knowledge unit. So by measuring the distinct sentences or the distinct paragraphs, if you want, that exist in worldwide repositories, for example, in Britannica and Wikipedia and so on, this can help you, first of all, define the knowledge unit and then measure knowledge. But whether this is a good approach or not, I'm not a specialist in this area, but I'm willing to investigate, to co-investigate. So if any of you wants to do any research on these topics, then we can cooperate. For example, as I've told you, one way to analyze symbolic knowledge and its quantification is to go to Thesauri, to go to and start counting articles in Wikipedia, Britannica, and all encyclopedias that exist. This could be a way. And of course, text analytics can help a lot because there is the redundancy there. So you can try to minimize the redundancy before measuring. And of course, there are some major societal issues that are related to knowledge quantification. If you see in the left-hand side, we are in the zettabyte era nowadays, and we see that we have an exponential growth of data. So if you really want to cope with data, it's next to impossible, in my view. So better turn our attention towards abstraction and the creation of symbolic knowledge. If you on the right hand side, you see the increase of the number of articles in Wikipedia. Of course, this is this just reflects one aspect of knowledge increase, and it can be influenced by many different factors. But let's suppose that this is now true. You see that the increase in the last years is sublinear. So this means that we can cope with it. But if we can cope with such a knowledge increase, then this means that we have to find abstraction mechanisms as a new learning paradigm, for example. Besides doing my scientific work, I try also to read a little bit around on the philosophical aspects in this domain. A couple of months ago, I read this book by Patino on the called Fish Civilization. It's a little bit technophobic, but it's very interesting because it poses several issues primarily related to social media. So if you really want to spend some time philosophizing, you can just use it. And if you know other books that are on AI epistemology, please tell me and I'm going to put them in this list as well. I prepared a book in this area, which I call AI Science and Society. First of all, the question is, can we qualify to speak about AI science? This is an issue because people speak about web science, also data science. So can we claim that we do AI science? So this is a question. The first issue, of course, is what is AI science? So in there, we have data, we have signals, we have mathematics to use, that we use them for analysis, we have systems, and then we have various AI sub-disciplines, for example, computer vision, deep learning. We have the issue of semantic concepts and knowledge that we have to define, and then other issues related to autonomy. So I try to handle all these topics in this book as sections. I have a reason why I tell you what I have done. We are going to see it in the next slide. Then the second topic is which are the relation between AI and humans. First of all, of course, you have to study a little bit neuroscience and what is sensing and perception and issues that are go beyond neuroscience towards psychology. For example, what is self-awareness, what is consciousness, and then how you can apply this AI to medicine, ambient assisted living, living minors, and so on. The third very important topic is the impact of AI in society. We already know that there is a huge impact. So we have to treat topics like what's identity, what's intellectual property, what is the effect on justice, how we can have the, as I call it, ex machina arts. This means machine-made arts, how we can do computational politics and so on. And the last part, of course, is how we can use AI to tackle issues related to life, biology, and the environment. The reason I mention this structure to you is that if any of you wants to have a look at parts of this book, send me an email message and I can send you the respective section for review, because I really welcome your comments on this. I already sent this. You know, there is difficulty in this undertaking, that there are so many topics that are addressed, from ethics and philosophy to deep learning to neuroscience, and I'm not expert in any of them, in all of them. So I had to send sections to colleagues that were kind enough to review them for me. So if you are interested in any of these chapters, let me know and I can send this to you. So that's all on my side. Before concluding, I would like to tell you that knowledge quantification also has several aspects on DNA and training, because you know that how we can quantify training as an increase of knowledge, how we can quantify forgetting, and not only this, how we can quantify how we can transfer knowledge from one agent to the next one. And I could go even further from an epistemological point of view, and I can argue that possibly we can study together human education systems that are based on primarily on the teacher-student model, and the AI learning. Possibly we can find good interplays between the two. This is the third challenge, as I put it in the document that I sent. So that's all I'm going to say. Are there any questions either to myself or to Niccolò? Well, as I've told you, maybe those, some, at least for my challenge, some of them may look like abstract ones, but we do research on some of them, and if you are willing to cooperate, then this is fine. This is more than welcome. Niccolò, do you want to add anything?
Well, no, maybe just a comment on what you said. I agree that there is an epistemological problem in
a little bit louder, please.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, somehow is hijacking the mic. Okay. I agree with you. There is certainly an epistemological issue in contemporary machine learning. For instance, are we really doing science by training large neural networks without being able to access the knowledge that these networks are learning, other than observing their behavior, by measuring their performance in prediction. So in this sense, I think explainability in AI can play a very important role, because it's allowing us to open up the box and read what's inside, or at least to probe in a certain way what's inside. I'm not claiming that everything should be explainable. I mean, in certain applications, I don't think explainability plays an important role, but in other domains, it is obvious that it's extremely important. But it's also fascinating the fact that we are able to construct larger systems that behave almost in a human way in a certain limited domains. There are, as you were mentioning, there's no way to communicate in a symbolic way or in a different representation than other than the weights than the knowledge that they represented. I think this is quite a challenge, and it's really posing the questions, what kind of science are we doing when we create these systems? Are we doing any science at all, since we are not able to open the box? Okay. Sorry.
I did not hear you that well, Nicolo, but I would like to point out that explainability, you know, could be a way to move towards, to move from data-driven learning to towards more abstract thinking. It's a very difficult problem, and as also Jens Kombatsiadis mentioned earlier. For me, that could be the biggest contribution of explainability, because if explainability can help us form concepts, for example, then there is a hope that it's going to be practical also for justice or for other. But if it cannot help us to create concepts, then it's going to be something artificial that it's useless. But it's definitely a good way to investigate things.
Yeah, I'm sorry if I wasn't speaking aloud, but again, somehow Zoom is hijacking the mic, and so I'm trying to.
Yeah, now you. Is there any other point? I see a comment about ethology. I did not mention anything about ethology. I mentioned things about ethics, and ethics is a discipline of philosophy, of course, and it has two different aspects. One is to do ethical research, and the other thing is whether we can quantify ethics. Can, for example, create artificial systems with certain behavior and derive ethical rules out of those simulations? I think Bakunin and some other anarchists had such ideas in the past. Now we can put it into test and check whether, you know, by having agents that steal a little bit or more than a bit, and let them play around, whether we can really find one of the commandments, not steal, that it's good for the society, out of based on simulations, for example. Anyway, ethics is a very important topic, not only for ethical research and privacy and these things, but it can be a research topic by itself.
Yeah, sorry. I didn't talk about ethology. Maybe it had to do with
somebody else talk about it. There is a remark.
No, yeah, right. Ethology commentary refers to Nicolo's point of view. Point just now. I was talking about epistemology. Maybe the mic was too low and it got right. So the fact that creating larger, training large systems, not being able to access the knowledge produced by the systems poses an epistemological viewpoint on the fact that what kind of science are we really doing when we train these models that we cannot really understand afterwards. I see. Now I see the connection. Right. So we can do definitely, yes. So this is the, now I understand, because I made a point that, okay, you can observe behavior, and by observing behavior and maybe by, you know, trying, performing experiments, you can infer, right. Yeah, you can infer the something about the, about let's say what maybe the animal learn and knows about the environment. That's definitely true. So you're suggesting about an ethology of it's not exactly empirical, that didn't make a science.
Well, no matter what, you know, I think that a nice new term has been proposed, like learning ethology. So we can use it as a head for those studies. This is a nice term. We need such terms to promote the work that we do. Is there any other comment? artificial ethology or Latin ethology. Yeah, this is a good term. Thank you. So you own this term, you can copyright it. Is there any other point? If there's no other point, then we can close the first part of this symposium, and then we can restart again at 2 o'clock p.m. Central European time with topics on social aspects that are really very interesting. And some of them are important for us as well. For example, can we persuade somehow the European Union to be more lenient in us using data for doing our research instead of creating hassle to us? So these are topics that we're going to discuss in the next part. So see you again at 2 p.m. Central European time. Okay, bye now. Have a nice lunch.